between pre-show and main card after almost 7 hours. 7 hours! Never again! WWE, 7 hours! I think we finally got our answer with WrestleMania 32. Was this going to be the show that the WWE needed, and was it going to deliver in a big way? Or was it going to be the show that many of you expected it to be and feared that it would become? Honestly, perhaps the most notable thing about the pre-show is how many people that actually bought tickets to go to the event at AT&T Stadium missed out on some, if not a majority of the portion, of the pre-show. How in the hell do you not have the logistics figured out in terms of better ways to be able to verify and scan tickets? The Wi-Fi isn't working at AT&T Stadium. For Christ's sakes, even Comcast thinks their service sucks. Did you try unplugging the router, waiting 30 seconds and plugging it back in? Did you think about having a backup? Holy Christ, what an embarrassment. And shame on everybody involved for that happening. And how ironic, at AT&T Stadium, there were internet issues. But in terms of the actual pre-show that some got to see live in person and many others just heard about through their social media devices, the U.S. title match between Ryback and Kalisto was what it was. It was an okay match, but there isn't much story there other than the fact that one guy's big and one guy's small. And yes, that story can work to a degree, but it would be nice if you had something more to it than what you got. So it is what it is. The 10 Divas tag match was far better than recent Divas tag matches at WrestleMania, that's for sure. Let's not pretend like we cared a whole lot. Let's not pretend like we really care that Brie Bella won here. I mean, I could sit there and say, why not put somebody else over that's going to stay? But then you give her the moment. Who gives a shit? And frankly, who gives a shit to the Usos and the Dudleys, too? I mean, as I'm just sitting there watching the match, it just left me with that lingering sense of disappointment because I'm like, these guys should be on the main card. These guys should be wrestling in a TLC tag title match, and instead they're wasted here in a really goddamn short match that had an awkward ass finish, and then afterwards you prolong it, then the Usos put the Dudleys through the table, and it's like at this point in time I'm saying enough is enough, let's get on to the main show. And what a way to kick off the main show with this IC title ladder match. This was the right spot on the card for this match. This was the perfect match for this spot on the card. WrestleMania 32 needed to start off in a big, kind of spectacular fashion. And this match most certainly delivered the goods for me, and I think a lot of other people too. In a lot of ways, honestly, this was a perfect match for its slot on the card, in terms of the responsibilities, in terms of what it needed to set out to do. It did basically everything. It was really, really good, and I cared about it far more than I expected to heading into the event. And it was so much better than last year's. Like, if you think last year's IC title ladder match was better, you're living in some Daniel Bryan fantasy land. Go kick yourself in the cock, because this match was far superior. This felt like a crash test dummy ladder match at WrestleMania should feel like. Props to Sin Cara for all the shit he did, and frankly, props to all of these guys too. And heading into this match, I thought there were only two options here. Two legitimate, viable options for guys to win. And no, it wasn't that fuckstick Dolph Ziggler. Fuck Dolph Ziggler and whatever the fuck he was wearing. And no, it wasn't stupid El Generico Sami Zayn. Ole! The moment wasn't right. This wasn't his time. It didn't call for this. To me, it was either about Kevin Owens or it was about paying respect and giving it to Zack Ryder. And I'm sorry for those of you that are pissed off that Sami Zayn didn't win, but tough shit. For those of you that are upset that maybe Kevin Owens didn't win, I kind of get you to a degree because I can understand the thought process of wanting Owens to get that big spotlight, wanting him to get that big victory here at WrestleMania. But this finish worked. And it was the correct booking call, in my opinion, on a night that was so lacking in terms of spot-on, correct decision-making. And a night that was lacking in developing things for post-WrestleMania and continuing stories and creating new stories. This is one of the few finishes of the night that actually hit all those key indicators. It checked all the boxes. Now with Zack Ryder winning in the way that he did, and most notably Kevin Owens and Sami Zayn not winning in the way that they did, you can sit there and have Zack Ryder spin off as the IC champion, have him feud with The Miz, and you create a second feud here because, frankly, Kevin Owens versus Sami Zayn, for those of you who still get off on that shit because they've been doing it for frickin' ever, they don't need the belt. If they don't need the belt, then why use it? In fact, if anything, it's better off that a story doesn't involve the title because the title could potentially get lost in the shuffle. I would rather Zack Ryder feud with The Miz for the IC title because there I know the title is going to be of preeminent importance. Kevin Owens, Sami Zayn, not so much. Now instead of taking this match and maybe possibly creating one feud for post-WrestleMania time, you've created two. And you've given people a real feel-good moment. For those of you that sit there and say, "Woo, Zack Ryder winning, you missed that boat 4 or 5 years ago." You're the same fuck that would be coming on here and praising it if Dolph Ziggler fucking won. He's had that opportunity I don't know how many fucking times. Get over it. This was a good decision in a night full of, frankly, bad decisions. After the craziness and the greatness, frankly, of what was that IC title ladder match, the only match on this card that could follow it up properly was AJ Styles versus Chris Jericho. Heading into this show, I thought card structure and flow were going to be critical to this event, as frankly, honestly, they are every year with WrestleMania. And early on in the night, the WWE, I thought, was clicking on all cylinders. They were really doing a good job here, and most importantly of all, they were slowing down and taking their time. Unfortunately, later on in the night, they took way too much time. But AJ Styles, Chris Jericho, perfect second match on the card. Even though we've seen these guys wrestle several times, it still felt like that mid-card mania match where there's no titles. It's just about pride, ego, who's the better man. With two well-established characters, what would happen in a match at Mania? You still got some of those elements here with Styles and Jericho. It didn't quite have the same luster because they have touched several times already, but there was still an appeal there. And this match did exactly what it needed to do. It kept a good flow of the show. It told a solid story while providing a contrasting style to the opening match that was Crash Test Dummy High Spot Fest all over the place. You know, this was a spot fest with solid storytelling. Even though there were the occasional awkward, choppy exchanges or moments here between these two guys, it still worked for me. It still did what it needed to do. Now, in terms of the finish, I'm okay with Chris Jericho winning here, and I'll tell you quickly why. AJ Styles winning may have been too predictable here. At the same point in time, you can't have Chris Jericho lose every single time in a major show. Otherwise, you do get to that point, if you hadn't already gotten to that point with him before, where you're sitting there looking at him and say, why would you ever bother watching any matches he's involved in? Because you think he's always going to lose when it matters. And you're not building the character that way, so why would you do that? Furthermore, did you really think Vince was going to put over TNA at his biggest show of the year? Especially knowing that last year, for Christ's sake, Sting in his first ever WWE match at WrestleMania 31, he didn't go over. And we thought AJ Styles was going to go over here? And if anything else, for those of you that love to get off on match, if anything now, you have a premise with the way the finish was executed with Jericho utilizing the referee for another match next month or later this month or whatever the hell. I'll be tuned out by that point in time, but a lot of you should still be able to circle jerk to this. If anything else, I can understand why people think this was a questionable decision, and I'm not saying it was the best decision, but I get the decision and understand the decision, and I'm not really going to knock the decision. So up to this point in the show, I thought the WWE was 2 for 2. I thought they got everything they needed out of the IC title ladder match, and I really liked how the whole AJ Styles Chris Jericho match played out. I was liking and digging the card structure, the flow of the night, unlike previous years where it felt like they rushed like mad through the first hour and then really had to bog themselves down to compensate later. This year, the flow was really good early. They just got bogged down later. Big difference. But then when they brought out the New Day to face the League of Nations next, I'm like, I don't know if I really put this at this spot on the card. But I guess it all ended up working out. It doesn't change the fact that there are some things that bother me about this. Not the entrance, even though you've got three grown men coming out of a box of cereal that is called Bootios. I'll look past that. At least these guys were deemed important enough on a night lacking in big, spectacular presentation, movie-style type of entrances. They were one of the few groups or people that got that. It's the fact that you've got one of the most entertaining acts you have right now, week in and week out, in your entire product, some of your most over superstars, and you're sticking them in here in a match of absolutely no real consequence. The tag team champions are not defending the tag titles at WrestleMania, and why is absolutely beyond me. You wasted the Usos and Dudleys on the pre-show. You could have still kept the League of Nations involved, made it a 14 TLC tag title match, and it would have fit in with this show, and it would have helped this show tremendously, and we didn't get that. Now, seeing what played out, I understand it. But at the end of the day, what I don't understand here is, you know, at some point in time, the WWE really lost their way, and I think it was somewhat intentional in the sense of they didn't want to create new stars. They want to use props to a certain level, knowing that the name and the brand draw, not the individual performers, and the WWE has created that environment. It's like if you actually believe that any of the wrestlers involved with this show drew over 100,000 people, you're fucking insane. People have been buying WrestleMania tickets months ago. People are buying the tickets because of the brand, because of the event, because of the spectacle. They don't even know what the hell is going to be the match on the show. You know, like the main event or any of the matches when most of these people buy their tickets. But I just can't understand for the life of me why, when the New Day should be the ones that are being spotlighted here, and in a way they still were, why we're not giving them this moment in the sun by having them win at WrestleMania 32? Because they matter. The League of Nations matter not whatsoever. A heel faction that gets no heat, that you are doing really nothing with. They are Triple H's amateur-ass lackeys occasionally, but not consistently. And you put them over here. It's literally like Vince McMahon sat there and said, I just can't do it. I can't put over the black man at WrestleMania 32 because I'm sorry, at the end of the day, that's exactly what the fuck it felt like to me. This was a mediocre Raw match where the wrong team won and it took a lot of the air out of the venue. Now maybe at the end of the day when you look at what happened here as a result, you know, it set up very well for what came next, but it was so disappointing for me. The New Day needed this spotlight. They needed to win this match at the biggest show of the year and they didn't get it done. And that's ridiculous. But of course, what the WWE does is they'll find a way to divert your attention away from that. And even on a night like this, the way the show was going, even when I felt the WWE had made a bad choice and made a bad call with having the League of Nations go over the New Day here, they found a way to totally and completely redeem themselves, even if in spite of themselves. Here's Shawn Michaels. Here's Mick Foley. Here's Stone Cold Steve Austin. Holy shit. Shawn Michaels is in wrestling gear. It's fucking Foley, it's fucking Austin at WrestleMania, and they've come to kick ass and drink beer. You take the rules, you crumple up the paper, and you throw it in the fucking fireplace. This was a WrestleMania moment. So even when the WWE was screwing up, they were still getting it right, and they were still making magic happen. So at this point in time, after three matches, I was feeling really, really good. And I'm sitting there saying to myself, you know, I don't want to get too ahead of myself, but damn it, I feel like this company's doing really good. And this show is really heading on a good path with all of the big feature matches yet to come. I thought we could potentially be in store for a special night. And then the Dean Ambrose, Brock Lesnar street fight happened. And oh, this street fight. You know, this was the perfect place on the card for this match. So heading into it, I'm looking at it and I'm saying, the structure of the show, the flow of the show has been generally good. The way each match has finished has been good. This is shaping up to be special here. And now you're talking about you've got Dean Ambrose and Brock Lesnar in a street fight. This is one of the three featured money matches for this year's show, with easily the best story of the three major featured money matches, with arguably the most interesting characters and perhaps the most interesting and versatile stipulation with a no-holds-barred street fight, as redundant as it is to say that. So many people heading into this match would think that this was going to take this show to a whole different level. Or if he didn't like what happened early on, this was going to help redeem the WWE and start saving the night and help sending it into a positive trajectory. And many of us, myself included for sure, thought that this was ripe for match of the night possibilities. That this was going to be the fight, the match that would steal the show, perhaps be the most purely memorable match from this entire event. And then the actual street fight happened. What a steaming pile of monkey crap this fucking was. This was easily the worst match of the night. And don't you bring up that fucking Andre the Giant Memorial Battle Royal. That was about something else entirely different. That's not about match quality. That's about certain things. You're talking about a match that you've been building up to for 2 months with two of your most featured performers in the WWE today. With a stipulation like this, with Paul Heyman involved. And this was the turd that we got served up. This was easily the worst match of the night. And one of the worst fucking street fights I have ever seen. This match sucked big felonious donkey dick. What in the bluest of blue fucks was going on in the decision making and match structuring here? This was terrible. Who books a fucking street fight only to sit there and have the street fight primarily take place in the fucking ring? Who the fuck books a goddamn street fight where we're emphasizing Brock Suplex, Brock Stomp, Bronk F5? Literally, we emphasize suplexes more than goddamn extreme stipulations, more than the damn weapons. It was basically a kendo stick. It was chairs, a fire extinguisher, and a chainsaw that didn't get used, and a barbed wire baseball bat that didn't get fucking used. This was shit. And then to top it off, one of your three featured matches of the night. One of your three money matches, and you give it 13 minutes. You gave more time to the women's triple threat match. And that's not to say anything bad about the women here, but that means that there should have been more time allocated to this match, especially when you see the turd fest that you were fucking served up on a silver Dallas-sized platter. I mean, holy Christ. Especially knowing the show still almost went, in terms of the main card, almost 5 fucking hours. You still only found a way to give this match, the actual action, 13 minutes. The action itself was slow and fucking dull as hell. I'm tired of the Brock bots defending his 2-3 move having ass. You know, here you would think, if anything else, he could do more. He could sit there and do some interesting different things. This is going to be a fight that feels different than anything else on the card. Instead, Brock Lesnar is suplexing and stomping around like a jackass. And I don't even know what the hell Ambrose was doing, frankly. This was dumb. And no, you could take your it's PG excuse and shove it up your fucking ass. We've seen plenty of good street fights and extreme stipulation matches during the PG era since 2008. That is not an excuse here. This match just fucking sucked. And you could sit there and blame the WWE, and you could blame the match structure, and you could blame the booking, but you got to blame the performers too. You've got to come with better at the biggest show of the year in front of over 100,000 people. This is the turd souffle that you fucking serve up, and then to top it all off, you take this shitty match that does nothing for either person involved, and to top it off, you have the wrong guy fucking win. No, Ambrose needed this spot. He needed this WrestleMania moment. Somebody at some point in time needed to fucking beat Brock Lesnar. And you had the perfect excuse here with the street fight. Dean Ambrose could have thrown everything at him, including the kitchen sink. But we couldn't bother to find the kitchen fucking sink because we didn't bother to use fucking trash cans or any other goddamn weapons. You did all that shit with the baseball bat and then it didn't get used ultimately. You did this shit with the chainsaw and it was dismissed quickly. A kendo stick and steel chairs do not make a no-holds-barred street fight, especially when you have it primarily take place in the ring. And then on top of that, Brock Lesnar wins. It's like the ultimate what the fuck. The match sucked. It brought down the show significantly for me. And to top it all off, nobody benefited, and the wrong guy fucking won. How could you be so stunningly stupid, WWE? I guess I shouldn't be stunned, because I know on a consistent basis you establish yourself to be this stupid. When you want to talk about choke jobs in sports, this match right here at this show was an epic choke job of massive proportions. And you're going to sit there and tell me that Dean Ambrose was more deserving of a fucking main event spot? Kiss my motherfucking ass! Ultimately, that street fight was a real turning point for the night in my book, and not necessarily in the good way. Now, the thing is, though, is right after this, you dive right into this triple threat WWE Women's Championship match. Thank God these girls were there, because they definitely saved the night, at least temporarily, for me. I'm digging the new women's title myself. They finally got rid of the stupid butterfly belt. The rebranding of the division. You want to talk about Divas Revolution? You needed to rebrand it, so I'm all for it. And I appreciate the way they tried to make this match feel like it was big. Not a big women's match, but just a big and important match on the WrestleMania card. And there's a significant difference there. You know, having Lita come out and introducing and unveiling the belt, to Lita being out there, to, you know, all the different things they did in the lead up to this match felt big, and it felt like it belonged on WrestleMania, which most years you can't say about a women's or a divas title match. And then for me, you know, you've got Ric Flair there. You had just introduced all the 2016 Hall of Fame inductees. Now here comes Snoop. Snoop! He's leading Sasha Banks to the ring. I'm saying to myself, fuck that street fight. This is the moment in time I have lived for months. This is what the Schlagetti needs. But it wasn't to be. Yeah, he led her out to the ring, but that was that. And my disappointment is mess. Now, I will say this match had some sloppiness, which sometimes triple threats can be. And sometimes all three of these ladies can be a little sloppy and a little botchy. Their matches can seem to be a little bit choreographed. They can seem a little bit kind of... What's the word I'm looking for here? A little too structured, like a little too planned out. They don't always flow well. It's like a little hesitancy, a little choppiness to get to a spot. Then you kind of right yourself, get to another spot. But overall, the ladies worked hard, busted their asses, and were far superior on this night to fucking Brock Lesnar and Dean Ambrose. That's for goddamn sure. This should have been one of the three featured money matches for WrestleMania, because it sure as hell delivered a lot better than that fucking shitty-ass street fight. These ladies worked hard, they busted their ass, and at the end of the day, they delivered a solid match. Until we got to the finish. I just don't get it. Some of you are going to sit there and talk about Charlotte being established as a heel champion, and that's fine. There is an argument to be made there. But when you've got Snoop there, he's there! He even led Sasha out to the damn ring! And you're going to get Ric Flair involved in the match. At some point in time, if there's ever going to be a show where there should be an overcoming of that for the babyface, and there should be some type of payback and comeuppance for the heel interfere. One should think it was fucking WrestleMania. There were so many things on this night that were pointing to this should be Sasha Banks' moment. And this is Sasha Banks' time. Just to sit there and go right back to freaking Charlotte anyways. And you could literally feel it. When she won the match and she got that women's championship, you could feel a collective... You can sit there and try to spin it and say it was heel heat and it's a way to establish a heel, but it didn't fucking work. This was one of these examples of where the WWE yet again goes against the fans and what they want in a particular night without really having a good reason or justification for doing so. This was set up in a certain way, and then when you sit there and book this finish to play out the way that it did and you had that particular person win, it just let a lot of the air out of the sails of this event if the freaking street fight didn't do so already. Now, if there's one match that I'm not really sure how to feel about on this card, it has to be Shane McMahon versus The Undertaker inside of Hell in a Cell. As soon as I saw that this match wasn't going to main event, I said, ugh, I already know the finish. I already know what's going to happen here, so why even bother watching the match? And then the match started off very, very, very slow. And I understood that this match was going to get 25 to 30 minutes, which it ultimately did, I think, get about 30 minutes. So it was going to have to start off slow. But it maybe started off a little too slow. It took a while for this match to really kick into gear. Now, once it did kick into gear, it kicked into gear. And it evolved into basically what I expected. These two guys were going to sit there and beat the hell out of each other. And Shane McMahon was going to bump his ass off. And Taker's going to be the one that gets the credit for it. You know, I ended up enjoying it, but it was very weird because it felt like, to me, a lot of a lose-lose situation heading into this match. If Shane McMahon loses, you brought Shane McMahon back for really nothing, just for this match. That's disappointing. Yet if you had Taker lose here, he's never going to wrestle at Mania again. You don't want this to be the last WrestleMania match of The Undertaker. So instead of picking a side, it's like you didn't want to pick any side. And it's not like it's something that you eagerly anticipated or wanted to see how it played out, because there was always going to be that feeling of dread and regret in the back of your mind. Or at least there was with me. And I look at this match, and this was a clear and present example of how much more it would have meant if the streak was still intact. It would have helped the suspense of this match significantly. It would have helped the intrigue of this match exponentially. I still can't understand why Vince McMahon was nowhere to be found with such an important match with so much on the line. The whole storytelling element of this was frankly ridiculous. And the lack of overall sensible storytelling in the build-up to this match really honestly made this feel like a random match. Now, these guys went out there and busted their asses, and they deserve props for the effort. Shane McMahon in particular, he produced that Shane McMahon moment that we knew he would. But at the end of the day, like I said, once this match did main event, I knew who was going to win. Furthermore, knowing what that meant about what match was actually going to main event, I'm like, ooh, I don't know about that. And then when you look at, there was no story, there was no reason to really get invested in this. Yeah, you could sit there and try to fool people with the spots and everything else. But when all's said and done, this is part of the problem with The Undertaker being streakless at WrestleMania. It kind of eliminates the point and the purpose of him being there. You just don't care the same. It just doesn't mean as much. And even throwing in a Shane McMahon wasn't enough to save it here, because the story was so asinine and so ridiculous. It not only felt like a random match, it ultimately, to me, felt like the past several weeks and everything involving these two guys in the lead up to this match, and then even this match itself, was just one giant waste of time. I mean, count me as one of those people who was really surprised that the Andre the Giant Memorial Battle Royal was so late on this card. I was stunned and surprised by that. But I think it ended up working okay, especially with the direction that WWE went with this. I personally wasn't looking forward to this match anyway, so I enjoyed the mini Rumble surprises. You know, here's DDP. Here's fucking Shaq. Randomly, I see Tatanka in the goddamn ring. And, you know, there were elements here that I liked. It felt like a little mini Royal Rumble. And, you know, that was okay because I didn't need a whole lot out of this match. And it still found a way to give me something. And I'm okay, even though I would have preferred Mark Henry winning here in his home state of Texas. I'm okay with Baron Corbin winning. You know, this is a way to spotlight somebody new, and on a night where you've had a lot of interesting and puzzling decisions and a lot of the focus hasn't been on the future, it's frankly been on the past, and you could see where the emphasis of the WWE was to go all in on one night and fuck everything else, which was an understandable philosophy. This was one of these few things where you could look at it and say there's something big picture going on here. And so I'm okay with Baron Corbin winning. I just have a problem with the fact that you're going to have this guy win and he didn't even get a damn entrance. You know, it's not even until a few minutes in before they're really even spotlighting or mentioning Baron Corbin in any way, and then all of a sudden he's a surprise victor. You know, it shouldn't have happened like that. You want this victory to be like a big deal, and it can be a big deal and a real launching point for Baron Corbin's character on Raw going forward. They should have at least given him an entrance, if anything else. But again, the Battle Royal at least produced something positive. And for that reason, amongst others, fucking seeing Shaq and Big Show stare down. Now, that's something that should have been a WrestleMania match one year. This was far superior to that shitty street fight between Dean Ambrose and Brock Lesnar in every way fucking imaginable. Now, after all of that, I'm looking at the clock and I'm saying, jiminy Christmas, we're almost 4 hours into this. Are they really just going to predictably bring out The Rock and him get involved with Triple H Roman Reigns? Is this main event going to be that short, like 15, maybe 20 minutes? Oh, no, 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 no! I still had another hour to go! Holy Christ. So we get The Rock, and he comes out to the sizable pop with a freaking flamethrower. So he shoots flames out of this and flames out of his ass and fucking sitting there setting letters on fire and all this other crap. And he's out there. At first, he's talking about the attendance record. It's a WrestleMania attendance record, not a U.S. indoor attendance record. Disappointing for WWE, I'm sure, of 101,767 people. Now, I'm sure Dave Meltzer and or Brian Alvarez are already probably taking to their devices to tell you that only 80 to 85,000 people were actually there. But whatever. Fuck them. Anyways, I'm sitting there saying to myself, you know, is that really what they brought him out here? Is this really what he came up with? Because this is a giant waste of my fucking time, and I'm starting to get a little tired here. You know, so many other things you could do with it. And then I'm also thinking, too, where the hell the Wyatt family been all night? They're really not going to get involved with this show whatsoever. Well, I got my answer. And here comes Bray Wyatt after The Rock says his little piece. And, you know, the actual face-off, the actual promo between The Rock and Bray Wyatt was very good, and I like how The Rock put Bray Wyatt over within the individual promo. But once that happened, it was Rock and Big Name time, and fuck the Wyatt family. So apparently The Rock has come to wrestle, so he wants to face anybody. So here he is, setting a freaking record, pinning Eric Rowan at WrestleMania in 6 damn seconds. I'm like, holy Christ. That's what they did. That was his grand idea. Oh, but no. We get more because this segment just won't fucking die and it just won't end. Now we've got the Wyatts all staring him down and you know what's coming. You know John Cena's running out. Not anybody else because The Rock and John Cena could beat 3 men just between the two of them. Hell, they probably don't even need the help. So here comes a lean, mean John Cena. Looking kind of strange, actually. But John Cena's back. And I think the people are legitimately happy because, frankly, it wouldn't have felt like WrestleMania if he wasn't involved in some way, shape, or form. So here The Rock and John Cena clearing house and kicking ass and taking names. You know, if there was ever going to be that moment, and I won't even say that about Cena turning and saying, as Rock was sitting there trying to rock bomb somebody, Cena would freaking give him an AA. I won't do any of that. Won't get y'all giggly tits about that. Setting up a third match between the two of them in WrestleMania 33. But, you know, it's like one of these things after this kind of splashy spot fest of a night where you've already brought out HBK and Foley and Austin. You had Snoop there. We've seen Ric Flair. You've already seen Shane McMahon, The Undertaker, so on and so forth. Now you get The Rock. You get John Cena's returning. It's like it's cool on the one hand. I probably would have enjoyed this a lot more, though, if it didn't take so goddamn long to come to a point. And actually get to the point. It's part of the thing I dread about Rock stuff now. Is whenever you see him, you could tell he's a movie star now because he thinks everything he's involved with should be as long as a freaking movie or at least a mini feature. Jesus Christ. And at this point in time, you know, I want to get ready to go to bed. Maybe that's me just getting old. But I've had enough of the night already. And now we've got The Rock and all of this crap. And as long as this took, and I know that God is still main eventing, so I'm going to get a long main event title match. It's like, enough is enough, and let's move on. I would have enjoyed it a lot more maybe if it was earlier in the night, or if between the pre-show and the goddamn main card, WrestleMania wasn't almost 7 damn hours. So now we're at this point in time, over 4 hours into the main card, and finally the main event is here for the WWE World Heavyweight Championship. Over 4 hours in, the WWE was determined to main event this match, whether you wanted them to or not, or whether they should have or not. And in particular, shame on me as your prophet, of God's word, God was the champion heading into WrestleMania. There was never any other possibility or alternative. This match was going to main event. Out of stubbornness and ego and holy magnificence and Trinity as much as anything else. My goodness. Praise God. Praise God. Now, I understand why a lot of people are shitting on this match. They were ready for the end because this was a long, long night. And the last thing you wanted to do after being disappointed with some other things on this card in terms of decisions or some of the matches, in particular the street fight that was god-awful and terrible, the last thing you wanted to sit through was a standard wrestling match where you had a Hell in a Cell match as one of your featured money matches, and you had a street fight that disappointed, it was horrible and god-awful as one of the other featured money matches. Here was going to be a standard wrestling match. And it was going to be a very long standard wrestling match where you knew what the destination, you knew the ultimate result was going to be. And a lot of you were determined to rebel against that and resent that, whether you have some legit reasons to not like the Roman Reigns character or you're just doing it to be part of the cool crowd, I don't know. But I could understand why a lot of people did not like this match and thought this was the appropriate culmination to a crappy night. I have to say, though, that I personally did enjoy the main event. In spite of the fact that I was dead-ass tired at this point in time, this match got me interested. I was involved in this match. I cared about this match. And heading into this night, I wasn't sure that I was going to. These guys got me interested. They might not have gotten some of you interested, but they got me interested. I actually thought that this match did tell a story, and a good, appropriate story at that. And in part, it was a match about the future and who was going to be the featured standard bearer for the company, whether you like it or not. Roman gets his WrestleMania moment that was denied to him last year. And I have to point this out. We're going to sit there and hear a lot about how they lowered the mics to drown out the boos, and they did. You're going to hear a lot about how people were apathetic during portions of the match, which, to be fair, they probably were in part because they were fucking tired. And imagine some of those people that had been outside for hours waiting in line to get into the venue early on in the night. They were really ready to get the fuck out of town, get the fuck out of AT&T Stadium. But when Roman speared Stephanie, the crowd really popped. Maybe it was because they wanted to spear Stephanie, but not with an actual wrestling move, with their pee-pees. And she had that whole lesbian dominatrix thing going on. That was pretty nice. But when Roman pinned Triple H and he won the match, there were a lot of arms raised. There was a pop. It was there. It was almost like people, in a way, were saying, "Yay, Roman beat Triple H. Oh, no, I'm not supposed to like Roman Reigns, so I'm going to boo now." We can get creative in our history and what actually happened, but that is what happened. A lot of people jumped up and raised their hands up. A lot of people did cheer initially. The initial pop was there. And then when people were determined to crap on this and hate on Roman Reigns, that's what they fucking did. Now, with all of that being said, I sit there and say that Roman Reigns, to me, has been involved in two straight really good main events at WrestleMania. I realize I'll be in the minority on this, and I don't fucking care. But there is also that element that creeps into the back of my mind that says, what was the point of this? And here's what I mean. Ever since Survivor Series, you've been building up to this moment. Ever since Survivor Series, you've been launching yourself in one direction, which was Roman Reigns versus Triple H for the title at WrestleMania 32. You knew all along where this was going to go. You got no major swerve, no big surprises. On a night full of big surprises, this was the one match I probably could have used a big major surprise, and frankly, it didn't get it. And when you look at how everything played out and the fact that this match went almost a half hour after almost 5 hours of main card and another 2 hours of pre-show, and knowing that this is where they were going to go at the end of the day and it was predictable and there was no real surprise, to me, just like the other two featured money matches on this show, in a different way this time, this ultimately was, in large sense, a gigantic waste of time. And that's the best way I could put it. The main event, even though I personally enjoyed it, and I was at least a little happy to see Roman get his moment, not like overwhelmingly excited, but I thought it was okay. I thought he performed well here. I thought Triple H performed well here. And again, I realize I'll be in the minority. At the end of the day, did it really matter? I don't know that it did. Because the WWE was going to do this the whole time. So why spend 4+ months building up to this moment? It does feel like it was just a gigantic waste of time. So now, taking a step back and looking at the entirety of WrestleMania 32, heading into this event, a year ago I was incredibly excited about the possibility of this show. In the weeks and months leading up to it, I increasingly got that feeling of dread and impending doom because I thought this show could really, really suck and be very deflating to the fans and the product and the company as a whole. But I still held out that hope that the WWE was going to pull the rabbit out of their hat. They were going to sit there and pull that rabbit's foot out of their ass. They were going to find a way to get it done. And early on in the night, it sure seemed like my thoughts about that were right. I thought they started off really, really well. They had matches in the right spot, especially the first two matches and even the third match where they had made a ridiculous decision. They had completely and totally vindicated themselves to where you forget about the ridiculousness of the decision. On a night where a company like WWE in particular would usually get it wrong to spite themselves, early on, they were getting it right in spite of themselves. And I'm sitting there saying, man, this could shape up to be a really, really awesome and special night. I can't wait to see what happens. But then again, that Brock Lesnar, Dean Ambrose street fight happened, and it all went downhill from there to me. In general, there were several questionable decisions in terms of who you had win. You know, I'm okay with Jericho winning, but I understand why a lot of people aren't. I'm not okay with Charlotte winning. I thought it was a dumb decision, and I thought it really deflated the crowd. You know, whether Shane McMahon or Taker won, it meant the other lost. It was a no-win. It was a lose-lose situation. Brock Lesnar going over Dean Ambrose was absolutely completely freaking ridiculous. I mean, just several questionable decisions throughout the course of the night. And ultimately, you know, I had talked about card structure and flow of the show and the importance of managing time well. I did not mean sit there and create an entire extra hour of WrestleMania main card. This show was way too goddamn long. It just was. We should not be sitting there when we already have to watch 3 hours of Raw every week and be expected to watch an almost 5-hour WrestleMania. That's insane. And I think as the night went along, it started to really affect people's opinions, especially when it came to the main event, even with their preconceptions they already had and their beliefs that they had and their views they had heading into the match. Frankly, that main event wasn't going to be able to change some people's minds no matter what. It was always going to be what it was going to be, and people had already made their determination beforehand, which I don't think is fair, but it is what it is. This show was not the epic that this company needed to be. This was not the great memorable night that this company had to have. I do not think it will ultimately be the disaster that many are going to make it out to be. I don't think it was that bad. But at the end of the day, it ultimately ended up not being that good, which is really disappointing with the way the night started off. And you had some good matches on this card. You know, but when you look at the street fight was terrible. The Hell in a Cell felt random. And then the World Heavyweight Championship match. All three of the featured money matches ultimately felt like colossal wastes of time. And when I'm sitting there and being expected to watch between pre-show and main card almost 7 hours, I don't want to feel like I'm wasting my time. And if there is anything I can ultimately say about the entirety of my WrestleMania experience, my WrestleMania 32 weekend, it felt like a waste of time. and that's how I'm going to remember this show. It could have been so much more than it ultimately was. It will be more than a lot of other people are going to make it out to be, but a really, truly disappointing night that, to me, if anything, perfectly encapsulates the WWE of today. What's the point? What did you set up for the future? Where's the payoff to a lot of this stuff? You know, just questionable decisions, you know, dragging the shit out way too long. It was a waste of time, let's admit it.